Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
You know, song you were singing, the first one, but unless you speak to me, see, I won't know what to do. Sometimes we listen to so many other spirits. Spirit of those on TV, spirit of those on our jobs. And sometimes we forget to hear the Holy Spirit that can lead, guide, and direct us.
Yeah.
We have to keep that in mind. Unless God tells you, see, everything else is foolishness. We have an opportunity now to communicate with God corporately. We're going to ask that you would come forward, if you could, if you will. Those who come to the altar, some of you might want to remain by your seats. Some might want to stand, whatever and how that spirit that speaks to you leads and guides you. Amen?
Amen.
But won't you come now and we think about how good God is, how he even allows rain to fall on the just and the unjust.
Yes.
And same with the sunshine. I don't know about you, but I declare he's a good God. Cares about our needs, takes care of our needs, and every now and then takes care of our wants.
Yes.
And God is just like that. We're so blessed. Let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Father, as we enter into your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise, your word says, be thankful unto him. Blessing. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Psalmist said, I've searched the world over. I found that there is none like you, Lord. No one so kind, no one so understanding. No one so patient and compassionate when it comes to his children. And I thank God this morning that we can call him Father because we are his children. Someone told me a long time ago that they call him Abba Father because Abba is a personal name. It's like calling him Daddy. That's the kind of relationship we should have with the Lord. Not someone that's so far off and lofty and lifted up that we can't touch him. But we can touch someone who's acquainted with all our cares and our woes. Oh, I'm thankful this morning, Lord. I'm thankful that we're still in the land of the living. And you've given us voice. You've given us a mind that has stayed on you. Oh, Lord, we bless your holy name. Today, when we think about the goodness of the Lord, for if it had not been for your goodness, where would we be today? Lord God, we don't have to send you anywhere. For David said, even if you're in the heavens or if you're on the earth, even in hell, you're already there. But we do ask one thing, Lord, that you would draw us closer to you. That you will cleanse us, Lord, and Lord, take away our iniquities so that we might walk with you and as you talk with us and you lead and guide us and you fold and mold us and put us in a manner in which you would have us to go. As we do that, Lord, we give thanks because you're the only one who knows our every need. In the midnight hour, you know us. In the noonday sun, you know us. All throughout situations through the day, you know us and you still care and you still love us all the same. So we come with praises on our lips, Lord. We're coming out with our heart, Lord, saying, Lord, we love you because you first showed us how to love even one another. Now, Father, we pray for this world, even the craziness that takes place, for you know all things, Lord. Begin to put man together, Lord, in the way he should be. That we would be kind to one another. We would be merciful to one another. We would be just and honorable before one another. Because those are the attributes that you have. Now, Father, bless all those who are going through something. Let them know that there's a way through, that they're just going through. There's another side. And when we reach the other side, we'll be with you in eternity. So now, Lord, bless the service. Bless all the leaders and laity as well, that we might have a mighty time in rejoicing in the God of our salvation. This is our story. This is our narrative. You are God all by yourself. There is no one like you in all creation. We thank you, Lord, and give you praise that comes from within. In the name of Jesus, we pray and ask. And the people of God said together, amen and amen. Somebody go back to your seats. Greet somebody before you go back. Never let you down. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for the joy.
Thank you. Good morning, Mount Moriah.
Good morning.
I stand before you on behalf of our cardiac disparity.
Woo-hoo!
We will continue to walk. You want to walk? So we're going to have another walk. We're planning it, and we want to plan it for a different place. So if you have any suggestions, please, I'm welcome and I'm open to wherever you have one. You're welcome to walk wherever we can on a different note. I have a bunch of these booklets. They come from Rouse, I believe. They gave me a bunch of them. Inside of it is a wealth of information. They are free. So I'm giving you your first batch, and they come out every 3 months. There are a bunch of reasons what eggs you should be eating, depending on your blood type or your activity or what you're allergic to. There's it's an article in here about medicines, that if your allergies, and natural foods to eat. It gave a couple of recipes. There's coupons in here. There's a wealth of information in it. So I'm putting them out for you, and you all are welcome to it. If I need to get more, I will. But again, it's free, and it has a wealth of knowledge inside. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Remind everyone that we have our church baseball game tickets available. All the dates are in your bulletin. Next week starts those days, so please see me. We have Wednesday afternoon with Pastor's team, the Philadelphia Phillies. So there's three left for that one, and we have a Friday night game that is June 7th. Against the Washington Nationals, and then we have a Thursday afternoon. School should be out on June 5th, so that's an afternoon game. So the park in the park is a great time. Please see me. Amen.
Amen.
Also, I'd like to give you a quick update, church, that on June 8th, next Saturday, the men's ministry is hosting a boys' fishing trip at Santee Lakes. I talked to Brother Fred. And he said nobody signed up yet besides David. So if you have a boy, a young boy, that is potty trained, go to the bathroom. On their own. We're supervising, but they better go on their own. Please, please, please see Brother Fred today. Give him a holler or a phone call, me, so we can make sure we have enough food for the boys. Amen. We're not discriminating against the girls. We're going to have something for them in August.
Amen.
So this is a boys' fishing trip before Father's Day. Amen.
Amen.
Lastly, I'd like to give a quick update on our pulpit committee. We've been meeting every Tuesday, and we've been praying religiously on our new pastoral search. Amen.
Amen.
So please keep us in your prayers. You will be seeing forthcoming will be some church surveys, so we can find out what you would like your new pastor. Amen.
Amen.
It's not about us, it's about Jesus.
Amen.
So we request that the entire church keep this process in prayer, that the Lord will bring us a new pastor that has his eyes on Jesus.
Amen.
And moving our church forward.
Amen.
Not only in this community, but the entire San Diego County. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless you all.
Everybody shake the devil off already. I didn't see y'all doing it. I saw them up there. I saw Felicia. And everybody know Felicia? Felicia got one dance style. It's been like that. How long there? Yeah, forever. Yeah, but she can't help it. She, at least she know how to dance one way. But the choir was up there, everybody was shaking the devil off. Y'all ever shake the devil off? Huh? What if they just, well, somebody talking the devil off that day. What if we, before we all move to the middle, what if we show our little step when we shake the devil off? You know, those who can. Okay, Aunt Alice, that's all right. I remember when I used to, you know, be a little, have a little too much, that used to be my little dance. We'll say that one. We won't have that one in church. But can we get a little shake the devil off? And then after, we're going to ask that those on the ends, we'll all come towards the middle, our seats. Shake the devil off.
You can't beat God giving. When you give, He has a way of returning
more back to you than you could ever imagine. So I want to encourage you in giving this morning as the ushers are prepared to take up the offering. Give your best gift ever. Amen. The only other offering we're going to have is at the end, we'll have benevolence. But that's it. So give us God has blessed you to give it this time.
Y'all been over their house. Y'all seen seen everything that they're able to do. But more than anything, they are people of God. She is a woman of God. I'm going to tell you something, Reverend Cooney. I sit back there in the back and I listen to your messages. And the last couple of messages I've been listening to have grabbed me by my heart. I'm not a man afraid to say that I cried. I'm not a man afraid to say that, hey, God's got me and He used you. So we want you to come up today and just allow God to use you. Use you to the fullest. She's a psalmist. She's a preacher's preacher. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, Reverend Cooley. Come on now. Give God praise for her.
Oh, I always have a bunch of stuff, so let me sit you down. Good morning, saints.
Good morning.
Now, I think y'all look beautiful. Just smile a little bit. It's all right. God is here to bless us, eh? Amen.
Amen.
We are here to be blessed. We are here to be edified. We are here to hear the word of God and to encourage one another. I want to continue to say that.
Right.
Heavenly Father, I just thank you for everyone that you have brought here today, those who wanted to be here but could not, Heavenly Father, we pray for them. Those who are on their way, Lord, we ask for traveling mercies, Heavenly Father. And let me be removed, Lord, so that whatever it is that you would have the saints to hear, that they can hear. In Jesus' righteous and holy name I pray, amen. As you all know, the women of Mount Moriah, along with our sisters in Christ from True Faith Missionary Baptist Church, attended our annual retreat last weekend. That's right, give it up. I would like to share with you some of the highlights of our retreat. We began by helping one another stand firm on the foundation of a relationship with God, discussing the book of Ruth. The women were challenged with building a lodge from supplies given to them in a paper bag. The thing is, each bag had different building materials inside. So as the women completed their lodges, it was obvious some had better building materials than others. In life, we are given different building materials to work with as well. Do you think you were given adequate building materials in your life? Some might have had a childhood filled with love and affirmation, while others did not. Some might have had the opportunity for a quality education, while others did not. Some have had good health, fulfilling jobs, meaningful relationships, and others have not. Many of these things seem to be out of our control, and they often seem unfair. One thing that each of us had in common, however, was our foundation. Each woman was building on a table, which was our common foundation. During our retreat, we looked closely at two women from the Bible who had to deal with what seemed to be low quality building materials. But they chose a common foundation to support one another. Let's look at the book of Ruth, Naomi and Ruth. Now, Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. After they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died. And Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband. When she heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, Naomi and her daughters-in-law prepared to return home from there. With her two daughters-in-law, she left the place where she had been living and sat out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. Then Naomi said to her daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show kindness to you as you have shown kindness to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Many of these things seem to be out of our control, and they often seem unfair. One thing that each of us have in common is our foundation. Each woman was building on a table, which was their common foundation. These women had to deal with famine, moving away from the support of family and friends, the death of husbands, and for Naomi, her sons, fear of being without money or a home, and so much more. No wonder that Naomi felt God had made her life bitter to the point where she said, "Don't even call me Naomi no more, call me Mara," which means bitter. But even though she felt life was different, she never turned away from God.
All right.
God was still her foundation.
Yes.
And when Ruth clung to Naomi and proclaimed her devotion, she said in verse 16, "Don't ask me to leave you and to turn back. Where you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die. And there I will be buried." Ruth had known Naomi long enough to know that of her faith in God. And when she said, "Your God will be my God," she was letting Naomi know that she wanted this for her life as well. These women chose God as the foundation of their lives. No matter what else was given to them, they had a firm foundation with their faith in God. We have the same choice to make that Ruth and Naomi had. Will we make God the foundation of our lives? Think about where you are with God right now, and whether you are standing on the firm foundation of relationship with him. Don't wander into the shifting sand of worry and doubt. Find peace in knowing the strength of God is the foundation of your life.
Yes.
During that session, when we were asked to get a foundation piece so they could start building their foundation on Christ, during session two, the women had an opportunity to get to know one another by playing board and card games. The catch was that in the middle of their game, they were asked to change tables and pick up a game where the other group had left off. Now you can imagine what this was like. Then each group was asked to return back to their original game and pick up where the last group left off. Like Naomi and Ruth experienced constant changes in their lives, we too have constant change in our lives. Moving from table to table gave us insight into how we approach the constant changes in our lives. Some changes are welcome, like a new baby in the family. Other changes are unwelcome, like if your car broke down, you don't have money to get it fixed, and now you have to take public transportation to work. Change is inevitable.
Yes.
Change is inevitable.
Yes.
It's how we handle the changes, wanted or unwanted, that matter.
Right.
Am I going to fall apart because my car's not working? Am I going to fall apart because my husband left me? Am I going to fall apart because someone died? Or am I going to stand firm on the foundation that I have chosen for myself, stand firm in God? The Bible tells us, lean not on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Session 3 took us to Ruth chapter 2. The women have arrived in Bethlehem, and Ruth tells Naomi that she wants to go into the harvest fields to pick up grains of stalk left behind by anyone who is kind enough to let her do it. Ruth found herself working in a field that belonged to Boaz, the relative of her father-in-law. Boaz, as we learn, extends kindness in practical ways by offering food, water, protection. Naomi shared things of encouragement and wisdom, and each of them offers what they have to support the others. We started discussing our foundations, our relationships with God. This is the sturdy ground we build on. In the Bible account of Ruth, Naomi, and Boaz, we can see that these people were the support or the walls for each other. We can be the walls for others in our lives. Supporting them, encouraging them, protecting them. Consider how you can be a wall of support for those in the church. Consider how a word that you speak could be a powerful word of protection that your sister or brother in Christ might need right now. Think of a word or a phrase of encouragement. Know that the person you're sitting next to right now might not come here next week for some reason. What do you want your last word to them to be? A word of praise, a word of encouragement. Think now about a phrase or a word of encouragement that someone has given you. Think now about a phrase or a word of encouragement that you can give to someone else. Can everybody please stay? Yes, here we go. If you are not standing next to someone, please do so now. If you are not standing next to someone, please do so now. You are standing as walls of support for one another. You are standing as walls of support for one another.
Yes.
I'd like you to share your word of encouragement or your phrase of encouragement with the person on your right and or your left. Right now, share a word of encouragement. Share a word of praise with the person to your left or to your right. Let them know that they're a child of God. Let them know that you love them. Let them know who they are in Christ. Because we are the walls of support for one another. Whether we come here every Sunday, every other Sunday, once a month, once a week, once a year, we are the walls of support for one another. You may be seated. And if you haven't finished your word of encouragement or your word of praise, please do so. We are to encourage one another. We are to lift one another up. We are to praise one another. We are the Jesus that other people see. When we walk around, we want someone to say, well, I don't know what it is she's got, but I want some of that. And you know what it is? It's the Jesus in me. It's the Jesus in you. You are to encourage one another. You are to lift one another up. We are to love one another because God loves us.
That's right.
That's the least we can do. We're always told about how we can bring others in and how we can the strangers and talk to those who don't know Christ. But what about those of us who do? What about those of us who are struggling every day and haven't heard an encouraging word from someone? What about those of us who are sitting right next to somebody every single Sunday, but not a word has been said? We are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. If the salt loses its savor, it is no good for anyone. You're the salt, meaning that when someone comes near you or in your presence, they need to get thirsty for God. Okay? You're the salt. They need to be thirsty for whatever it is that you have. It's, I don't know what it is, but I want some of that. They need to be thirsty for the Jesus in you, because you are the salt of the earth. And you encourage, and you guide, and you lead one another. So let's go back to Ruth and Naomi, who are the equivalent of homeless, homeless people. In their culture, they needed a man in their family to protect them, to provide for them. They were without food, and we're at the mercy of others. I don't think we understand how much our praise and encouragement feeds us. I don't think you understand how much your praise and encouragement feeds someone else, and how much you need it. Each and every one of us needs praise and encouragement. We can't go without it. And when we do, something starts to happen within us that's not so good. People don't want to be around you. So Ruth and Naomi are without food. So Ruth offers to go into the fields to work, picking up stalks of grain that were left behind. This is sort of like somebody digging through the dumpster, looking for leftovers. I'm sure this was humiliating work, tiring, physically demanding, working in the hot sun. But Boaz offered protection by telling his workers not to harass Ruth. He also offered her water and a meal at his table, and asked his workers to purposely leave extra grain behind so Ruth could gather more grain quickly and with less work. It's likely that most of us know someone who has had a time of hardship. Perhaps it may even have been you. I remember when I was raising my kids, I didn't want to go to my mom and ask her for everything, even though she provided.
All right.
My mom had a little pantry. Could never figure out why she bought all those groceries when it was just her and dad. But then I figured it was for me. when I needed a little. So I'd go there with my kids and I'd do a little shopping. You know, I'd get some canned goods and some paper goods and, thanks mom, can I just have a little? Go ahead, help yourself. When I was raising my children, there were things out there that I could do to be a part of. There was a thing called share, where if you provided time, you got food, and you gave and you got it.
Yes, yes, yes.
So I would go and do my time with the program, and I would receive a box of food.
Right.
If there was a discount going on somewhere, I was there.
All right.
To clothe my kids, they didn't know it. I would go to the Goodwill. I'm only making $500 a month. My rent is $3, and I got 2 kids. I would go to the Goodwill. I've taken along a Mervyn's bag. I would buy these things from the Goodwill. I would put them in this Mervyn's bag, and I would bring them home because I could get twice as much for my money at the Goodwill than I could at Mervyn's.
That's right. That's right.
And I would bring it home. Look, guys, mom got you some new clothes. They were just as happy. It was new to them. They didn't know we were poor. They didn't know why I was fixing all those spaghetti squashes and and buying that meat that didn't cost a whole lot, because I could make it last a couple of days. I could get two Cornish hens for a certain amount, one, and I could cut it in half and feed each of them, and then I'd have another one and maybe some left over to make some soup. You do what you have to do to take care of your family.
Yeah. Yeah.
Things we can't control can literally leave someone wondering where the next meal is coming from. And since Ruth was out gathering barley, the women of Mount Moriah and True Faith made bean and barley soup bags. Bean and barley soup bags to give to others. So we gathered around and we made soup bags. We decorated them. This is mine, I didn't decorate. A gift of love. And these bags are going to be given to Jewish Community Center. To give to families.
Amen.
Our next session's purpose was to help everyone understand Christ's role as our Redeemer, and to see how God has provided shelter for us through Jesus. In Ruth chapter 3, Naomi gave some interesting advice. She told Ruth to get dressed up, go to the threshing floor, uncover Boaz's feet after he fell asleep, and then lie at his feet. Now that sounds kind of strange.
Yes, yes.
My mother-in-law is sending me to another man to lie at his feet. Oh my.
Yeah.
To some that might consider some wacky advice. But we've all been given wacky advice over the years, haven't we? I know everybody's shaking their head. Mm-hmm. So the women discussed some of that wacky advice we were given, like always wear clean underwear in case you get an accident. Everybody, yeah. If you drink, if you're a kid, you're trying to drink, can I have some coffee? No, you can't drink coffee. Coffee's going to stunt your growth.
Yeah.
I should be a midget. Don't pull out a gray hair because 10 more will grow in its place. I don't know how true that is, but I pulled it out when I was 25. So far, so good. The advice Naomi gave Ruth was sparked by her desire that Ruth have a permanent home. As a widow in a foreign land, Ruth had no protection, no source of income, and no security for her future. And we all know back in those days what that looked like. She would have to resort to one thing or another. During that time in Israel, what she needed could only be provided by a Redeemer.
Yes.
A person who could recover the land of Ruth's dead husband and provide the covering and protection that Ruth needed. This was a system that God had set up for his people so they wouldn't remain in debt, poverty, or slavery.
Yes.
He created a way for them to be free through the grace of others who were willing and able to pay the debt or recover their freedom. How often have you paid someone else's debt? How often have you helped someone else be free? It may be that person right next door to you that's struggling. And you don't have a clue because you never said, good afternoon, neighbor.
Yes, yes.
When Ruth asked Boaz to spread the corner of his covering over her, she was asking him to redeem her. This meant that he would buy the property of Elimelech, Chilion, and Mahlon, and take Ruth as his wife. Boaz was willing to redeem Ruth, and he had the power to do so. In Ruth 4, verses 1 through 12, It tells us, meanwhile, Boaz went up to the town gate and sat there. When the kinsman redeemer he had mentioned came along, Boaz said, come over here, my friend, and sit down. So he went over and sat down. Boaz took 10 of the elders of the town and said, sit here. And they did so. Then he said to the kinsman redeemer, Naomi, who has come back from Moab, is selling the piece of land that belonged to our brother Elimelech. I thought I should bring the matter to your attention and suggest that you buy it in the presence of these seated here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it, do so. But if you will not, tell me, so I will know. For no one has the right to do it except you, and I am next in line. I will redeem it, he said. Then Boaz said, on the day you buy the land from Naomi and from Ruth, the Moabites, you acquire the dead man's widow in order to maintain the name of the dead with his property. At this, the kinsman redeemer said, then I cannot redeem it because I might endanger my own estate. You redeem it yourself. I cannot do it. Now, in earlier times in Israel, for the redemption and transfer of property to become final, one party took off his sandal and gave it to the other. This was the method of legalizing transactions in Israel. Can you imagine? So the kinsman redeemer said to Boaz, buy it yourself, and he removed his sandal. Then Boaz announced to the elders and all the people, today, you are witnesses that I have bought from Naomi all the property of Elimelech, Chilion, and Mahlon. I have also acquired Ruth the Moabite, Mahlon's widow, as my wife in order to maintain the name of the dead with his property so that his name will not disappear from among his family or from the town records. Today, you are witnesses. Then the elders and all those at the gate said, we are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your home like Rachel and Leah, who together built up the house of Israel. Yes. May you have standing in Ephrathah and be famous in Bethlehem. Through the offspring the Lord gives you by this young woman, may your family be like that of Peter, be like that of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah. God provided the very covering that Ruth needed. God has also provided the covering we need by offering us the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ.
Yes.
He bought us at a high price, and now we have a roof over our heads. Jesus is our Redeemer, our refuge, our strength. He remains so to this day. As we neared the end of our retreat, we spent quiet time with God in different rooms throughout the hotel. Our final session reminded us that we need to continue to welcome one another and encourage one another. Let others know how much we love them, appreciate them, and see God shining through them. 1 Thessalonians 5:11 tells us, so encourage each other and build each other up just as you are already doing. 2 Corinthians 13:11, be joyful. Grow to maturity. Encourage each other. The spirit of love and celebration that the women experienced led us to the rest of Ruth and Naomi's story. God continued to be faithful and shelter them through all of their trials. In verses 13 through 22, so Boaz took Ruth and she became his wife. Then he went to her. And the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. The woman said to Naomi, praise be to the Lord, who this day has not left you without a kinsman redeemer. May he become famous throughout all Israel. He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you, who is better to you than seven sons, has given him birth. Then Naomi took the child, laid him in her lap, and cared for him. The woman lying there said, Naomi has a son. and they named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. This then is the family line of Perez. This is the passage of a celebration. Naomi and Ruth are protected and cared for. The women of the town praise God for his faithfulness as they are witnesses to what God has done for Naomi and Ruth. And Ruth is now a part of the family of David and a part of the lineage of Jesus Christ. We know that Jesus Christ is our Redeemer, our perfect Redeemer. He died on the cross for us. I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. Nor power in the sky above or the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Saints, we went to that hotel, we encouraged one another, we loved on one another, we heard about the story of Naomi and Ruth, we understood it, we grew to live it, and hope that each of you are continuing to live that story today, that we support one another, that we're encouraging one another, that we live with one another in love. Because that's all that God wants us to do. That's all that Jesus wants. Love one another as I have loved you. Love one another as I have loved you. It almost seems too simple, doesn't it? That all I have to do is love my neighbor and the world will be a better place. If I can't just get this into my head, then maybe I can get into someone else's head, but I have to be the epitome of love. I have to walk in love. I have to sit in love. I have to work in love. I have to show that love in the grocery store. I have to show that love to every person I come in contact with so that they will want to know more about Jesus. You are the salt of the earth. It's our job to flavor the world. Amen. It's our job to sprinkle some of that wherever you go. You can do it. I know that the women in here were encouraged and blessed. And if there is any woman now who wants to share about her experience in our retreat, I'm going to allow you that time to do so. We have time. We have time to do that now.
Amen.
So if there are any women who want to share about their experience, their Cozy Mountain Lodge experience, you know, we were not in the mountains, but we pretended like we were. You're welcome to do so now. Is there anyone who would like to share? Yes, my sister, come on in.
I remember last year on the way to the women's retreat, I remember feeling so sad and so disappointed because I was offered a job and then it was taken away that Friday. And I was so sad about it. I remember like sharing it last year. And then on the way to this one, I was thinking about it. And I was thinking how the Lord works in ways that I can't explain. Because on the way to this retreat, I had three jobs. And I had another one like just waiting to start. And I actually have this, I have so many job offers that I have to actually turn them down, and I've never been in that position where I would be like, I'm sorry, I can't work there because I have too many jobs. so it was and that whole trip colored my view. That whole ride colored my view during the whole retreat itself, because I realized that no matter what I'm going through, no matter what experience I've had, the same with Ruth and Naomi, it may seem bad at that time, but I never would have reached what God has wanted me to reach if I didn't go through that. I'm sure the Lord could have used somebody else, but if Ruth's husband never died, if she never became a widow, she would never have met Boaz, and David wouldn't have been born, and it would not have reached to Jesus Christ. You know, it was just those things that was coloring my mind during the whole trip, and I think it really helped thinking about it, comparing the past and what the Lord has done.
Yeah.
Anyone else would like to share?
My mommy.
I just wanted to share one activity that we did this time that was different than anything we've ever done. When we go to our final session, we're in there and we're singing, and usually people come. They don't ever come in, but they. So this time, Reverend Cooley, because we were unafraid, because we were in the Lord, Reverend Cooley marched us out. So we're walking around the hotel and we're singing. Some are looking, but some people, because I was observing, were actually saying the words to the songs that we were singing. That was a really moving part for me this time. Anyone else like to share? I know each of us had our own personal time with God and had an opportunity to see things in our own way. And as my sister Karen comes up.
Amen. Good morning, family. Amen. I have something really quick to share. I want to draw a parallel between the first time that I came to the animal conference to this time. My mom is 83 years old, 82. And I'm super busy all the time. That's no excuse, but I really don't spend the time with my mom that I should. And I know that. But we've made a commitment to this conference. And that's directly in response to the Cooley love, period. I'm really busy, so my sister-in-law paid my fees for me. My other sister got the room. I didn't have to do anything but show up.
All right.
And it wasn't just for me, but it was for the relationship that I had with my mom. So the first year that we went, there was a lot of conflict in my family. Lots of, so I came up in a very, very spiritually vulnerable state of mind. I was angry. I was angry at my mom, I was angry at my sister, I was angry at a whole lot of things. But the first retreat kind of just calmed the waters, right? Now things didn't miraculously improve among my family, but I can tell you the second time that we came, there was a measurable difference between the first time.
Yeah.
And so it just tells me how good God is, and you stay committed, and that if you keep putting one foot in front of the other, it may not happen when you want it to happen. The conflict is arising again, but I still have the foundation of building. I just pulled that out of my bag actually last week, that little cabin. Normally I just kind of toss that stuff aside, but it's on my desk at work. In my office, just to kind of remind me about building that cabin together. And if God says the same, my mother and I will be back again.
All
right. And she's also going to come next Sunday, so we'll see. I've committed to try and bring her here. And that commitment, really, I think I'm doing something for her, but I really know that that's for her.
Is there anyone else who would like to share their experience? You? You weren't there. Anyone else? So, as you can see, this was a joyful time. It was an encouraging time. It was a time of learning. It was a time of fun. As we're learning to go up steps, as we learn to go up steps, now know that she's being disturbed right now, she's gonna holler. That's my grandbaby. So this must be where her place is going to be later in life. Hallelujah. Is there anyone here who doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior? Is there anyone here that does not have a Redeemer or even know what a Redeemer is? We invite you to be a part of Mount Moriah Christian Church. We invite you to, as the deacons come, we have chairs. What we do here at Mount Moriah is that if you do not have a church home, we invite you to sit in one of these chairs. If you do have a church home and you just like some prayer, we invite you to come and sit in one of these chairs and one of the deacons will pray for you. If you're away from home and you just want to be loved on because you haven't had any in a while, come on down. And the deacons of Mount Moriah and all the members of Mount Moriah will love on you. Because that's what we do. That's who we are as the salt of the earth. As the choir sings. goodness. You must tell.
It's raining out here? It stopped? Hey. not for them. So we accept someone doing refreshments. Nobody doing refreshments. There is somebody. I know there's a couple of babies over there. Amen. A couple other things. Amen. We Jubilee is meeting today. Okay. Okay. What time and what is the drill? Will it be raining? I missed it this morning. I thought it would be what are we bringing?
1:00.
Okay, I don't know what y'all bringing, but I know something was in the crock pot last night and I smelled it all going. I just couldn't smell any meat. Essentials were picking up veggies and stuff over and over again. Must have been healthy, good stuff for me. Anyhow, all night in the crock pots, it just cooked and put stuff all through the air. Amen. Savory smelling stuff. So we're excited. Let's give, you know what? Sometimes we don't give credit what's due. I got to switch gears. But did the choir sing today?
Yes, they did.
Come on, y'all. They sang songs we hadn't heard. Amen. And almost made me want to, you know, in the offering song, I was watching Rev Brown and them back there. They were just doing a little bit. I don't know what y'all, what's to do? I don't know. I might have saw Witherspoon moving his head a little bit. The little song was just a little different. Just a little different, and I had to pinch myself, make sure I went out in the club. Somebody didn't pick it up while they were at what do you call that? Well, I don't know, what's the name of that club to do? Well, you just wait long enough, somebody will come out with something. I want to know what club you've been at. But anyhow, let's keep up and keep one another encouraged as the word was given that we are to encourage one another in the Lord. And if you don't know by now, if you can encourage one another, be like David, at least encourage yourself in the Lord and looking at what he has done for you. Amen. All right. We're going to get ready to dismiss. I missed my little buddy, but that's okay. All right, we had someone else that was representing this morning. Boy, I tell you, Lord has a sense of humor. Because see, back in the day, the kids would be in the back room under lockdown. Under lockdown. But today, our children are part of service. As long as it's done in a mindful and respectful way. Amen?
Amen.
So we're looking forward to some things. Let's give a benevolence. What a thoughtful, encouraging idea. Benevolence. First of all, I want to thank Mr. Eric.
Amen.
Thank Miss Karen. Those were some nice words. Did she? Karen showed up. Took the baby in there. She got baby watch. Okay. Yeah. But we're gonna take up our last offering, our benevolence. Amen. Let's give as God has blessed us to give. Some of y'all don't know. We get letters back from Red Cross and others where the money has gone, the amount that they received, and so forth. And then we do a lot of other giving as far as others when it comes to benevolence. Can I believe God not only honors benevolence, but he looks forward to sending the people of God who love him that are able to give beyond just the tithe and the offering. but it was making some difference at the right moment. So let's give as God has blessed you to give. You may not be able to give a whole lot, but you know, to whom much is given, much is required. Sometimes when we have so much within us, when we get back, blessings keep flowing. I'm just talking from what I know out of experience. Amen. So as you're giving, give as God has blessed you to give. How's my singer doing? You know I'm talking about you. Because I'm looking right at you. How you been doing? Things well? I said, how's it? Now you're the twin, right? Okay. Alright. Father, and how we thank you and we bless your holy name for all that you do. In Jesus' name we ask and say, amen. Some people put you on the spot, like when Cooley puts you on the spot. Pastor don't put anybody on the spot. I just try to keep it real. That's all. So you getting some songs together for us? This is what she would say. I'm just, you know, I wouldn't put you on the spot. But in the future, we maybe a song or two. Get the Lord, okay, all right, okay. This one, get everything. I mean, goodness, if we get Fred to get up and be part of the choir, Fred made a difference. Amen. You just sit back there and we see all the potential that God has placed in him, and we're thankful and grateful for those who are willing to get up and do thus saith the Lord. The Lord will supply the rest. So I'm thankful that we're there. And I want to give a shout out to while we have, y'all know pastor don't like too much time left. Y'all know that, right? Okay. But I'd like to give a little shout out to what's that guy's name? I know his wife's name, but his wife may be giving an A, his like his be giving an R. But they're doing something with youth. And they're serious about the work that they're doing with the children who come out on Tuesday. And there's a good number of children who come out from the school. And there's some teaching, there's some training going on, and then there's some feeding going on. Just want to say, if you feel at any time that you want to, on a Tuesday, provide some sandwiches or provide some pizza or anything that help out. It gets a little difficult when you're trying to do it all pretty much on your own. And then we start teaching and preaching things like, you know, we all in this together, blessing over here and blessing over there, and we help one another. So it might be, you know, might be nice to ask Angie, you know, how can I help out? Got to be a part of, or maybe a monetary gift, because these kids who are coming, I can tell you by the way they act, a lot of them need Jesus. I'm just going to tell you like it is, they need Jesus. And they're coming here on Tuesdays for a little over an hour, hour and a half after school, and we want to be able to reach them. So we want to be able to be prayerful, but certainly ask Angie. They bring, sometimes they come on one of them big motor coaches, that's what we call them now. And nice vehicles coming over, supplied, okay, by Angie. And Raj might be driving, and they're doing their part very quietly. They're doing their part. So you might want to see if you can help be a part of it. Why don't you just stand for a minute? So make sure we know people should know you. They're making a difference. God bless you. And we we want to take and change gears just a little bit. Me and the wife want to thank Bernadette for the vacation home that she's building for us. Did you finish up some on this past weekend? Were you able to get some things done? We went to, what do you call it, an on-site suite? That's where you come out, you're right connecting your bedroom. There's the bathroom and jacuzzi and all. What do you mean you didn't put a jacuzzi in there? That's on the outside? We don't need one?
The sea is right there.
Maybe it's not our vacation home. That's the one we were talking about. But anyway, be blessed in the Lord, and we will dismiss now, and there are refreshments on the side. Greet somebody that you didn't come in with as well. Somebody knows.